Hello everyone. I am so thrilled and overwhelmed by the massive interest in this project, and I still can't believe my last video got over 30,000 views in the first week. That's without a doubt a new record for me on my little retro computing channel. Even though I didn't have the firmware ready to upload code by the time I released the last video, and the only examples I had were in 6502 assembly, a crazy amount of people jumped straight in and ordered a shield anyway. I was expecting to ship out the boards I had in months, certainly not in just a few days. I know $9 isn't a life-changing investment, but I'm still so humbled by the trust so many people have put in me to keep this project going and expanding to more platforms. Thank you so much for the support. This time, I'm super happy to announce that the relatively universal ROM programmer got a few upgrades and now has, at least partial, support for the Arduino Uno and all the clones, of course, on top of being compatible with my very own 6502-based single-board computer, the 6500ino. As you can see in my little demo here, the Arduino Uno code currently supports calibrating the programming voltage, it can read the ROM ID if the chip supports it, it can run a blank check, and it can erase a WinBond W27C512 EEPROM with a 14-volt erasure voltage. Even better, I also managed to put together some code that'll burn ROMs via serial and read them back for verification too. That works on the 6500ino too, of course. If you don't want to play around with retro computers to burn a ROM, you're free to choose the platform you like, and it shouldn't be too hard to port the code. I'll get back to how the programmer works in a bit. If you're new to my programmer project, or my channel for that matter, what I've made here is a completely open source, both hardware and software, and super inexpensive EEPROM programmer that makes it possible to program the vast majority of parallel EEPROMs, even those with higher programming voltages, without buying an expensive programmer, which would usually cost about $70. Something you might want to avoid if all you want is to program a single $2 ROM. JLCPCB kindly sponsored this video and sent me the new board design, and I have some more news about that later, but for now, let's get it out of the box and see what's new. Like last time, I hurry up and get it soldered. If you order one from me, this is how it's delivered, without the pin headers and socket, and it's a big part of how I can sell it for $9 without taking a loss. The reasoning behind that is that pin headers and a DIP ROM socket is something a lot of people with this hobby already have, and the overlap of people who can do a bit of basic through-hole soldering is probably also pretty big. And manual assembly is also what would cost the most. This way it's cheap, and considering the popularity, I guess nobody minds putting on the headers themselves. For the last build, I made the mistake of ordering red LEDs instead of green ones, so I'm pretty excited to see what it looks like with the correct color. Not that it really matters though. Because I'm a little bit impatient to get this tested, I solder in a cheap 32-pin DIP socket. Since I want to test it with a 24-pin ROM this time around, I just solder in half the configuration header, since I can always add the other part for 28 and 32 pin ROMs later. But I better solder in the socket for the OLED screen right away. I haven't plugged the programmer into the Arduino Uno yet, but just used the 6500ino for the first test. Because it has a lot of cool features in ROM, we can just send over code via serial to call the check blank routine and nothing else. Even though the 6500ino only has 128 bytes of RAM, it's enough to hold instructions for quite a bit of useful things. Maybe even a small game, especially if we take advantage of routines in ROM like this. It's certainly enough to skip reprogramming the ROM a lot of times. All we have to do is run the assemble script, and less than a second later, the code is running. And it works! The green LEDs are a bit brighter than I was expecting with 4700 ohms resistance for the current limiting, but they certainly work. And even better, it looks like we have no trouble reading the ROM either. The code I've written ahead of time is just the bare minimum, so for now it has the programming intervals hard-coded to the WinBond W27C512, so to test sending a binary ROM file and programming it via serial, I need to configure the shield for 28-pin ROMs. I kinda regret I didn't just put the jumper header in there from the beginning. Easy fix though. The check blank routine also completes for this ROM, so we know the ROM is already blank. The code isn't super complicated, so I won't go into a lot of detail. If you'd like to ask me questions about it, please leave a comment, or even better, feel free to join my little retro computing clubhouse over on Discord. The whole thing is complicated a tiny bit by the fact that the only whole 8-bit port available on an Arduino Uno, and as a consequence also the 65 Arduino, is port D, which annoyingly is the same port we have the serial data lines on. And we need a whole 8-bit port to be able to write the registers and ROM kind of fast. To get around that, we could use software serial on two other pins, but that would mean we'd have to connect a separate USB to serial adapter, even though the Uno already has one built in. Instead, I decided to fix it in software. Since we need the whole port to read and write the ROM and control registers, we can't use the serial pins at the same time. To get around that, I split the data into blocks that can be buffered in RAM and read or write one block at a time. That does mean the serial port reads a little bit of junk while we're programming or reading the ROM, but that's not a problem as we can send a sync byte ahead of any data the other end should care about. That works because, with a little bit of luck, the junk data will never match the sync byte at the baud rate we use for serial. This little workaround does slow down programming because of the buffering, but not as much as using a whole port. With all that in mind, I've written a couple of Python scripts that should work on both Linux, macOS, and Windows without issue. One to send commands, one to receive a binary ROM file, and one to send a ROM file. I'm really doing as much as I can to make sure everything is as cross-platform as possible for me, so it should work no matter if your PCB is an Arduino Uno, a 65 Arduino, or, sometime in the future I hope, an STM Disco board for that matter. But speaking of the PCB, I wouldn't be able to make these videos without the support of my sponsor, JLC PCB. Even though I usually only do 2-layer PCBs, JLC PCB now has a promotion on 6-layer PCBs, with all the advanced features you just don't get with a 2-layer PCB. 6 layers means you get tighter tolerances, easier routing, less EMI, and it's much easier to put many components on a board like this. You can even get 5 6-layer PCBs for just $2 plus shipping, which is awesome. To test the 3 Python scripts in one go, I've combined them all in one script that simply sends a command to erase the ROM, sends the binary ROM file to burn in 32-byte chunks, and finally reads it back to see if it works. I have some delays in there since the 65 Arduino code waits for a timer to run out before it accepts the command. I can optimize that away later by changing how the 65 Arduino works. But the cool thing is that even with the delays, it's already a pretty fast way to write this ROM. Before I move on to show the firmware I wrote for the Arduino Uno, I'd like to show another little upgrade for the programmer. Since this is supposed to be a budget solution to program ROMs, I want to show a little trick I use if I'm not sure I'll be using a socket a few times or 1,000 times. In the last video, I used these pretty common and cheap SIF sockets, but for this one, I went straight ahead and put in a normal DIP socket. And the SIF I used before won't fit into one of those, and to be honest, they were kind of a pain to align before struggling further to fit them in the board. So luckily, I got an upgrade. These are a bit more expensive, but they're also a lot easier to work with. Especially because, unlike the other ones, they plug right into an existing DIP socket. That also means I can reuse it without desoldering anything. And even though the footprint is a bit larger than a normal socket, I can usually raise the socket I want to put it in with 1 or 2 extra sockets. Like if I wanted to use it on an old PC motherboard or the ROM socket on the 65 Arduino, for instance. Pretty cool upgrade. The other thing that got an upgrade is the PCB itself, that now has a voltage divider for the Arduino pin A2 to calibrate the programming voltage without bringing out the multimeter. I think it's about time we try the PCB out on my Arduino Uno clone too. There really isn't much to say about the Arduino sketch. It's basically the same functions used on the 6502 version, but with the Adafruit SSD 1306 library slapped on top and a tiny bit of code for making a menu system that I haven't backported to the 6502 yet anyway. But most importantly, we're taking advantage that the Uno has an ADC we can use to read the programming voltage on device without a multimeter. I can't really decide if I should add an ADC for the next revision of the 6502 Uno, as it's not really a period correct feature for a microcomputer board with features of the 1970s. But I guess it already makes some modern allowances anyway. It's not super easy to set the voltage exactly with the trim pot, and we lose a bit of the resolution of the ADC because of the wide range of resistance the voltage divider has to cover. But it should be plenty accurate to set a programming voltage well within the tolerances of most chips. On the W27C512 we have here, the datasheet specifies a quarter volt tolerance for the 14 volt erasure voltage, so we're fine. By the way, navigating around the menu is just a simple short press for next, long press to select kind of thing, and that shouldn't be too hard to implement on the 6502 version either. And of course, that also means the programmer is turning into a standalone tool that's pretty useful on my desk, especially considering my collection of refurbished ROM chips is getting to the point where I need a quick way to figure out if a chip works and if it's blank. Many, if not most, 27 series ROMs have the same ID feature as this one from WinBond, but I do have to be sure it has the feature before I risk grilling it by putting 12 volts on an address line that's just minding its own business. But for a 28-pin ROM with a quartz window, I'm certainly willing to risk it. So if I try to read the ID from it, we see 203D, which should correspond to an ST27C512. That's super hard to see from the markings on this one, but it certainly sounds very plausible. By running an ID check and a blank check, that's a pretty good indication if I've got a good or a bad ROM without even touching my keyboard. Of course, it can erase a UV EEPROM, but if you're interested in doing that cheaply, I recently made another video on exactly that. But for the electrically erasable ROMs, I'm happy I do have that feature, as I resell some of them and they sometimes just come refurbished with whatever was on them when they were pulled. Like the network boot code for a 90s Ethernet card, for instance. Pretty boring stuff, but I certainly don't want to sell chips with someone else's data on it. So this is what I have in place for now. There's an abundance of opportunity to expand the firmware, but for now I thought the most important was to address the fact that there's quite a lot of people out there with a programmer, but stuck with writing code themselves. The 6502 code is still somewhat attached to the 6502 Uno, so don't be surprised if you're watching this in a few months and things have been moved around. The Arduino sketch and the Python scripts already live in the programmer repository on GitHub, and it should be super easy to adapt the current code that expects a WinBond 27C512 to expect some other ROM instead. Code-wise, all you technically need to do is change the ROM programming interval and the ROM ID to the ROM you have. But I hope I can make a bunch of profiles in a somewhat standard format that will work on both the Arduino Uno and the 6502 Uno. You'll always need to change jumper settings physically on the programmer depending on the pin configuration and physical size of the ROM you have. If you've made it this far into the video, you might be interested in playing with all these gadgets too. So I've made most of them available on my webshop, as kits and refurbished vintage ICs are available too. Link in the description. If you want to get help, or even better, help out, feel free to open a pull request or an issue on GitHub, come hang out in the clubhouse on Discord, and I promise to read all comments here on YouTube as well. Either way, thanks for watching.